Collins is a librarian here at the Athenaeum, and he is...
He's here bringing in tea.
There he is. This is how it works here. We all do this kind of stuff. Many of you know him as the competent, friendly man at the front desk, and he is so much more. He is the genesis of this de facto series, and I would be remiss if I didn't do this introduction of Christian to say thank you to him. He is the literary translator for his friend, the author Osama Alomar, and this is the first book they did together. There's an excellent translator's note in the back of this book by Christian. It'll tell you a lot about his work, translating from Arabic to English for this work. In a review of this book in the New York Times, the meeting of Christian and Osama is described. This is brief, bear with me. Mr. Collins, Mr. Alamaz's translator, remembers meeting the writer for the first time in Damascus in 2007. Syria's President Bashar al-Assad had eased some restrictions on private gatherings, and Mr. Alomar was a regular at salons that had sprung up where invited speakers would address political, cultural, and social topics, but steer clear of directly criticizing the regime. Christian is quoted, "In the discussions that would come afterward, Osama's stories would come up spontaneously as a way of driving home an intellectual point in a poetic fashion. In the States, it is putting literature down to call it utilitarian, but for me it was quite striking to see his work put to this really concrete use." In May, Christian and I, and with the support of the board, we brought Osama Alomar here. He gave a talk here. He worked with Michael Arnowitt at two of his productions regarding the Syria situation. And from there, this whole series started to come together. So what I wrote here was, we brought Osama here. That in turn led to his involvement with two Syrian events put together by Michael Arnowitt, and through Christian, and through Allison Barkley, and through Robert Ford. We met Mohammed Hafez, this artist, and this is how the work was brought here. And it was really this, if you're going in the right direction, you just have to keep on walking. It was one of those events for us. The new book of Osama Alomar and Christian Collins comes out in April 2017. It's called The Teeth of the Comb. It'll be published by New Directions Press. Please welcome Christian Collins.
Hi, everybody. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm really excited to introduce our speaker tonight. I want to thank you all again, echoing Bob's words. Thank you for coming out for this in such great numbers, as you have turned out for all of the events in the St. Johnsbury to Syria program series. Throughout this summer, as we've done different events, starting with Osama's reading in the spring, going through to the art show, which is still here up until October 1st, that's Mohammed Hafez. It's been incredibly gratifying to see just this like will of people to learn more and to get a more nuanced view of Syria and the Middle East. We did a nonfiction book discussion group about Syria, and had 25 people turn out for, you know, when we were expecting about 10. So over and over again, there's just this desire to know more and to learn more and to get a more nuanced perspective. So, you know, as a public library, our root mission is to provide resources to the community for learning, for education, for pleasure. And those resources, even going back to the founding of the Athenaeum, have not been limited to books. You know, even in the original vision of Horace Fairbanks, it was art, it was the incredible roster of lecturers who spoke in this very hall over the last more than 100 years. And I think of Robert Ford and his wife Allison Barkley as true resources in our community. We're very, very lucky to have them here in St. Johnsbury, and it's been wonderful to work with them to make this series a reality. I'd like to introduce Robert by highlighting a few key aspects of his career. Robert Ford was Deputy Chief of Mission in Bahrain from 2001 to 2004. He was political counselor to the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad from 2004 until 2006. He was U.S. ambassador to Algeria from 2006 to 2008. He was deputy U.S. ambassador to Iraq from 2008 to 2010. And in the culmination of his career, he was U.S. ambassador to Syria from 2011 until 2014. He's widely lauded as one of the foremost Arabists in the State Department, really helping to, with his knowledge of the language and the culture, to help guide U.S. policy in that region based on a deep knowledge of the culture. In 2014, he received the Secretary's Service Award, the U.S. State Department's highest honor. He also received in April 2012 from the John F. Kennedy Library in Boston the annual Profile in Courage Award for his stout defense of human rights in Syria. And as you get to know more about Robert's career, you'll see that that defense of human rights is really a thread that runs all the way through it. So it's particularly appropriate tonight that we have Scott Gilmore here too from the Center for Justice and Accountability. Robert will introduce him more directly. I can also add now officially to that long list of prominent positions, one more, which is trustee of the St. Johnsbury Athenaeum. We're very, very lucky to have Robert and Allison here, and I'd like you to please join me in welcoming Robert Ford.
Thank you. Well, first, thank you very much, Christian, and thank you, Bob. Allison and I are coming up on 1 year in St. Johnsbury. It's been the fastest year of our lives. We're just so grateful to be here. It's really a dream come true. And one of the things that led us to come here, we were pretty happy in Baltimore, but this Athenaeum is such a treasure. And I can't believe I'm actually speaking at the Athenaeum. I better get serious. So the good news is, Bob said I didn't have to wear a tie. And this is true. I told Scott Gilmore, who's come up from Washington, and he's going to talk to you about what they're doing to bring Syrian war criminals to justice. But I said to Scott, oh my God, we don't have ties. We better put ties on. And this was the old Washington mentality. And so thank God we're in Vermont. So I'm going to talk, I think, about 30 minutes. I have about 14 slides. I'm going to talk about what's going on in Syria, and I'm going to go a bit into the belly of the beast. That is to say, this is not a fluffy presentation. One thing I noticed from the book club group that met here a week ago is there are a lot of people who are quite willing to dive into detail. And I live in the world of detail, and I worked in the world of detail. And so I'm going to do a little bit of that. And then I look forward at the end, after Scott and I talk, I look forward to a robust discussion. So with no further ado, except I do want to just introduce my much better half, Allison Barclay, for those of you who haven't met. And the real story is that in 1993, I wanted to visit Boston to see the autumn colors, and Allison said, I'm sick of big cities, we're going to Vermont. And I said, Vermont, we're just going to see cows. What are we going to do in Vermont? And then I immediately fell in love with it, as she did from her visit as a child here. So as I say, we're so lucky to be here. So with no further ado, obviously this is, Syria is the biggest world tragedy in the last 20 years. It surpasses Sudan. It surpasses Central Africa. It surpasses the Balkans. This crisis in Syria, a country that used to be 23 million people, has produced more refugees than any crisis since World War II. I want you to think about that. World War II ended 70 years ago. This Syrian crisis has produced more refugees than any other crisis. So it is an enormous human tragedy, and I'm sure some of you have seen these pictures on the top left of Aylan Kurdi, whose family fled in a raft like the one downstairs that Mohammed Hafez, the artist, put out. And then just last week, these pictures on the bottom right of Omran Dakhmish, who survived a bombing attack in Aleppo about 10 days ago. Omran's brother died in hospital about 3 days ago. So, but beyond the humanitarian, I mean, there's obviously a moralistic issue attached to the crisis in Syria and the human suffering, the unbelievable human suffering. But as American taxpayers and as American citizens, many of you have family in the armed services. Syria actually is even more than just a humanitarian crisis. We now have U.S. forces on the ground in Syria. Does anybody know how many U.S. forces are on the ground in Syria? They're special operations forces. Anybody know how many? 300, up from 126 months ago. We have 300 U.S. operators on the ground. In case you missed it, they were almost hit by a Syrian government bombing raid over the weekend. And the United States had to dispatch from an airbase in Turkey, had to dispatch F-16s to fly over where they are inside Syria and tell the Syrian Air Force to leave immediately, which the Syrian Air Force did. They don't want to mess with our F-16. But we have people on the ground. So far, nobody killed, thank heavens. In fact, I think yesterday or the day before was the anniversary of Joey Fortin's death. So I hope we don't have any casualties in Syria. I sincerely hope that. Very frankly, when I was inside government, I never wanted U.S. forces deployed in Syria. The president decided we needed them in to fight the Islamic State. The amount of money that it's costing is not huge by Washington standards, but it's about $15 to $20 million per month. This is just for Syria. This is not Iraq. This is not Libya. This is just what we're spending for the military operations we're doing in Syria. But it's almost $500 million a year. And you know what? The USDA could do a lot with $500 million in northern New England. So this is not chump change. And you people need to pay attention to that. More than just the military is the whole humanitarian. Half of Syria is displaced now. 12 million people have had to leave their homes. Out of that 12 million, roughly 5 million have actually left the country. And you saw the pictures of people streaming into Europe. There are 1 million in Jordan. There are 2 million in Lebanon. There are 2 million in Turkey. There are about 400,000 in Iraq. The people in Europe that you saw on TV last summer, they're the lucky ones. They're the lucky ones. We're the United States government, you, us, taxpayers. We are the largest single donor of humanitarian assistance to help these 12 million displaced Syrians. We're now at, I just looked this up on the internet yesterday, we're at 5.6 billion in contributions. You know what, even in Washington today, $5.6 billion is a lot of money. And we just, John Kerry in July at a conference he was at announced that he had increased it 440 million, has to be done with the Treasury and the Office of Management and Budget. That brought it up to 5.6. I am sure before the end of the year, before the end of 2016, they'll have to raise it another 200 or 300 million. The crisis is not going away. Crisis is, if anything, getting worse. So the total amount of money that we're spending is over $1 billion a year for humanitarian, roughly averaged out, plus the military costs. Could be up to $1.5 billion. So this is actually real money. I mean, even by Washington standards, that's real money. So we should care. There's a humanitarian side, and there's an American resource side. So what's going on? Bashar al-Assad, the president, has the longest neck of any human being I've ever met. You could see what he said. And Syria really is in the middle of the Middle East. I love pointers. Oops, I screwed it up. Bob! Do you know how to turn it back on? Oh, cool. One of the first things you learn when you're an ambassador is you don't have to do anything. People will always fix the things that you create and screw up. So, I put this slide in the show because I want to, I'm going to use my finger so I don't mess up the computer again. This is a picture of the airstrikes that are going on in Syria. And what I want you to understand is that so far, the Americans are involved in a sideshow. The Americans are not involved much in the main show. So the main show is the war between the Syrian government and the Syrian opposition. Started in 2011 with the peaceful protests, and it's devolved into a horrible civil war. Half the country displaced. 500,000 dead. But the American effort is not that 500 million roughly a year, the US military operations, the special forces. American is not involved in that at all. President Obama repeatedly has said, we don't want to get involved in that mess. So the American effort is only, underlined, only against the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. ISIS, some people will call it ISIL, Islamic State in Iraq and Levant. I actually just call it the Islamic State. So the American airstrikes, and the key thing in this picture, the blue. See how the American airstrikes are all over here? The real fighting in the Syrian civil war that killed Aylan Kurdi, Omar Dakhmish, that little boy covered in blood sitting in the hospital, that's all over here. There are no blue American airstrikes. The American effort is all over here. That's where the Islamic State is. The Syrian government forces, Bashar al-Assad, the bombing of the cities and all, that's over here. Here's Aleppo. That's where Omar was hit. And that's where the Russians are bombing. That's where the Syrian government is bombing. See, although there are some red Russian airstrikes out here, there are a lot more Americans. It's because the Americans are really going after the Islamic State. The Russians, sort of, but really they're more interested in helping Bashar al-Assad over here, no matter what they say to the media. And of course, you would not be surprised to know that the Russians don't always tell the truth in the media. So the Americans are sort of in the sideshow of the Islamic State. The main show, where the casualties are, where the worst bombing is, and where the brutality and the violence spawn the Islamic State. That's this area over here in the west, near the Mediterranean Sea. The Americans are not much involved in that. As I said, the bigger battle is between the Assad government and the opposition. And it goes back to 2011 and the peaceful protests. It is confusing. If I see one more article that says, oh, it's just very confusing, it's hard. So I thought, I'll break it down. Many people here, I see someone with a Boston Red Sox hat on. If you can follow the pennant race in the American League or the National League, you can follow the Syrian Civil War, because there are really only four teams. So I broke it down. There's the Syrian government team. There's the, what I call, moderate opposition team. This is not the Islamic State. These are the other people, basically, who have descended or evolved out of the peaceful protest movement. And these are the countries that are helping them, because this is now really an international war. You have the Syrian Kurds, who have their own agenda, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute, because they're in the newspaper today. And you have the Islamic State. Notice that there's no country really helping the Islamic State, ISIS. They're by themselves fighting everybody. They're kind of crazy. So really, that's it. If you can follow the American League East pennant race with the Red Sox, Toronto, Baltimore, and New York, you can follow the Syrian Civil War. The real question is, okay, so you've got these four sides fighting. Where is this going to end? Where is this going? And the first thing I want you to understand is that it's going to be really hard for these people, the moderate opposition, it's going to be really hard for those people to accept that Bashar al-Assad and his government stay? Why? Why don't they just give up? Why don't they just say enough? 500,000 dead, we quit. Well, the first is the war has been incredibly brutal. This is a picture taken by a Syrian doctor last spring. The Syrian doctors, there was a group of them, and I testified in front of the House Foreign Affairs Committee last spring about the Syrian government's repeated use of chemical weapons, even though they promised they would no longer do so. There's a United Nations Security Council resolution, there's an agreement between President Obama and Vladimir Putin that they wouldn't do it anymore, but they're still doing it. And this is a picture of a child who is in a chlorine gas attack. Chlorine gas is against the Geneva Conventions. It is against the UN Security Council resolution. Syrian government did it anyway. A whole family, this little boy survived, the rest of his family died. They suffocated when their lungs collapsed from the chlorine gas. There is a reason, after World War I, the international community said no more chlorine gas. Many people, including from Vermont, died because of chlorine gas exposure in World War I. We thought that little evil thing had been buried and put away. The Syrian government has brought it out again. And the Syrian opposition says, how can we live under a government that does that? By contrast, the Russians, remember the chart I have here, the Russians and the Iranians, heavy batters on behalf of the Syrian government, they want Assad to stay. And their goal, and they've been very clear about it, you can read it if you read about the Syrian war, their goal is that Bashar al-Assad remain in power. So you have this fundamental dichotomy between an opposition that says we cannot live with Bashar al-Assad and the backers of Bashar al-Assad and Assad himself saying we will not leave. That's, and that has been a stalemate since 2012. Now, what are the chances the opposition is going to just say enough, we're going to quit? This is why I think the opposition won't. These pictures, well, actually, I just put one in this presentation. This picture was brought out of a Syrian secret police detention facility outside of Damascus. It was actually only about 3 miles from my embassy in Damascus. These are about 15 of documented, and I mean documented, name, date of death, date of birth, where arrested. These are about 15 of 7,000 people who were killed between 2012 and 2014 in this one Syrian secret police detention facility. If you look at the bodies, and this is a nice picture, they're a lot worse. You will notice they're emaciated. Many of them show signs of beating. Some have their eyes gouged out. That is the treatment that the Syrian secret police meet out. And Scott Gilmore is working with some of the people who have survived this. This experience is seared into the memories of the Syrian opposition. This is what Bashar al-Assad and his people do to opponents. There is no free speech, there is no dissent, and there certainly is no armed opposition. Just in the past week, Amnesty International, which is a big international organization tracking human rights, just in the past week, you can Google this when you go home tonight, came out with a detailed report about not this prison, but a whole nother one. It's called Sidnaya. It's out in the desert near the historic ruins that the Islamic State captured and blew up, a place called Palmyra. It's called Sidnaya, and I just took a couple of quotes from the Amnesty International introduction to their report. I forgot to put in this slide. Amnesty International has documented 17,723 opponents of the government or suspected opponents of the government were killed in this facility, again, between 2011 and 2015. So it's not just like the government had a bad day at this one detention facility. They were doing it here too, even on a bigger scale. What I'm trying to impress upon you is this is a government that kills on an industrial scale. It uses chemical weapons. It puts people in places like this and tortures them to death. It uses barrel bombs, which I'm sure you've seen on TV. It's the way it operates. And so for the Syrian opposition to say, okay, we quit, they go home again, assuming their homes have not been blown up. Who's going to protect them if one of the four secret police, don't you love a country that has four secret police agencies? Who's going to come and protect them if there's a knock at 2 a.m. and they take you away? Think John Kerry's going to protect them? You think Vladimir Putin is? Ayatollah Khamenei? Who's going to protect them? United Nations, please. They know that. And they know that if they go home, and these guys, these are some of the heads of the secret police agencies. I'm not going to even go through the names. These are the guys. We know who they are. And just like we knew who the people of the Third Reich were. If these guys are still there, and they start arresting people on a large scale, is anybody going to do anything? I mean, you know the answer. No. So the opposition, they're not going to quit. They can't go home again until these people leave. John Kerry, bless him, will meet with Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov on Friday in Geneva. And again, Kerry is going to try to get a ceasefire, and he's going to try to get to a political deal. I have to tell you, I've actually was interviewed on Bloomberg today, as well as BBC. And I was asked, do you think Kerry's meetings are going to go anywhere? And I said, no, I don't. Because although there's a framework under the Geneva Communique, which calls for a new government, get rid of these guys, a new government, a unity government that would involve people that are not war criminals that are in the Syrian government now, together with independents or people from the opposition in a transition government. The Iranians have never agreed to that. Remember, Iran is big. They're a big backer of the Syrian government. They've never agreed to that. The Russians have never said that Bashar al-Assad or his security services have to go. They just say, we'd like a new government. But for them, that may mean we'll put an independent as the agriculture minister. We'll put an independent as the education minister. What's the education minister or the agriculture minister going to do when there's the knock on the door? And the opposition, this is exactly how they think. I mean, they're like, who's going to protect us if we agree to this? The opposition has its own supporters. Saudi Arabia says Assad's got to go. The Saudis have hated Bashar. It's personal between the ruling family of Saudi Arabia and the ruling family in Syria. They want him out. The Turkish role, Turkey being right north of Syria, a lot of arms are going from Turkey into Syria to help the opposition. Turkish role has been Assad has to go. Now, just in the last 2 weeks since the coup, the Turkish position may be evolving, and a lot of us are watching every word that comes out of the Turkish government right now to see if it's changing. The American stance, well, first the Americans, remember, are fighting the Islamic State. The Americans are not really dealing with this problem, and the Americans are not dealing with this problem. The Americans aren't dealing with these guys. The Americans are just focused on the Islamic State. The American stance, President Obama said in 2011, Assad must go. The Americans have done nothing to make that happen, nothing. And frankly, I think if Assad stays, the Obama administration would say, it's not our decision. So the end result is that with Saudi Arabia and Turkey on one side, and with Russia and Iran on the other side, you just get this kind of horrible balance where the fighting continues, neither side wins, it just goes on and on. More air raids, more killing, more displacement. So I want to talk to you about the latest idea that I've heard in Washington. I'm up here, thank God, but I go down to Washington occasionally, and this is an idea that's gaining some traction. Hillary Clinton has several advisors who are saying, well, what we need to do with Syria is partition it, just like the former Yugoslavia. Former Yugoslavia has been partitioned into Bosnia and Croatia and Kosovo and other Macedonia, the other countries. So there's thought that maybe it should be partitioned. So how would that work? How would you partition Syria? This is a map of who controls what. This map is 2 weeks old, so it's pretty up to date.
This is where the Syrian Kurds are, and the Syrian Kurds want to be independent anyway. The Americans have been helping them because they've been fighting the Islamic State. Joe Biden today was in Turkey. I dare say this issue was at least 50% of the vice president's time in Turkey, because the Turks are furious that the Americans are helping these Kurds in Syria, because these Kurds are calling for independence here and in Turkey, which naturally the Turkish government does not appreciate. So, but this is how much they control now. 2 years ago, it was like that. So it's gone from that to this. That's a lot of what your US taxpayer money paid for. They also control this little space over here. These are areas where Kurds, who are not Arabs, they have their own language, their own culture, their own tradition, their own history. There are Kurds here. There are also Arabs mixed in, which makes it harder. The Islamic State is this gray part. This is what Bashar al-Assad, with his Russian and Iranian friends, controls, red. And the other opposition controls this green area. And these lines, except for the Kurds, those lines have changed very little since 2014. It's almost like World War I. These lines over here have changed very little. And so the idea behind the partition, and there are both people inside the Clinton campaign and there are people inside the US government now, the Obama administration, are talking about this. Let's just get a ceasefire. The opposition will control these areas down here. These little dots are settlements or towns, cities. The opposition control that, Assad will control this, we'll give the Kurds this, and the Islamic State will be there to deal with the Islamic State. And the idea is, just like Yugoslavia, we'll just get a ceasefire and get them to stop killing each other.
Sounds like a plan, no? Phil Gordon, Jim Dobbins, people like that, people with experience in Afghanistan and in the Balkans are advocating this. Phil Gordon is a big person in the Clinton campaign. So, would partition work? So, I want to go back to the four teams that are fighting in the Syrian civil war. Would partition work?
Well, the Syrian government rejects partition. And Assad rejected it just earlier this week. They know what we're saying. They pay attention. They read the New York Times, probably over the internet. The moderate opposition, they reject it too. The Kurds like it. The Kurds are okay. The Islamic State, they're against everybody. And they reject it as well. You know, they're going to take over not just Syria, they're going to take over the whole Middle East and someday the whole world. So, but you have the two big sides in the big battle, the two big sides so far are against it.
I've been asked my opinion about the partition, and I've raised a lot of red flags. Beyond just the difficulty of selling it,
how stable are these lines going to be? These little dots, as I said, are little settlements or towns. So here's one. The Syrian government controls it. There are Syrian opposition places real close to it. Suppose the Syrian opposition says, hey, that's not your town, that's our town. What you gonna do? They're gonna start fighting again. Look how closely there are like towns and settlements up in here, or up in here around Aleppo, or down here around Damascus.
When one side says, hey, you don't get that town, that's our town, that's our village. How are you gonna enforce a ceasefire? How are you gonna control it? One of the things that a partition is almost certainly going to require in order to make it work is you'll have to have a big, wonking international force, UN or something else, with tens of thousands of soldiers to go into Syria to monitor it and separate the fighting sides. How many of you would like to put US Marines, US Army, in the middle of the fighting sides there? Well, do you think the Philippines wants to? Do you think the Pakistanis want to? Do you think Brazil wants to send their forces? I can tell you from my experience, if the Americans don't do it, nobody else will follow. They'll all say, oh, you're the Americans, you're the biggest, baddest dog on the block. What are you doing? And if we say, oh, no, we're not getting in the middle of that one, they're not going to either. So how are you going to monitor it? When you ask people who want this partition, they can't answer this question. Even if you get the ceasefire, how are you going to rebuild?
These areas here that the opposition controls, or that the Kurds control, it's not like they have a lot of experienced budget people. It's not like they have a lot of experienced city managers. Remember, the Syrian government out of Damascus ran everything. They didn't have local municipal governments that were empowered to do anything. In St. Johnsbury, we have people who collect taxes and are used to doing a budget and used to running programs. That never happened in Syria. Everything was done on a communist state socialist model from the 1950s, from Nikita Khrushchev's Soviet Union. That's the model Syria used. Everything was administered out of the center. So these people don't have experienced administrators. By the way, same problem in Iraq when I was there 10 years ago. We would try to get local governments to like generate jobs, to generate investment, to take care of education, care. They couldn't do it. They didn't have budget people. They didn't know how to run programs. What they did is they stole left and right, corruption like you've never seen. You will have the same problem in Syria. Would you? I don't ask this facetiously. Would you want to pay in to this? Because they'll need help. I've seen estimates now of $200 billion to rebuild. You want to finance that? Especially with the local government situation that I just talked about? Think about it. $200 billion. That's a lot of money. And if you don't rebuild, if the country just sort of sits there with the ceasefire, the refugees don't go home. The refugees that are in Europe, the refugees that are coming to the United States, the refugees that are in Jordan, Lebanon, and Iraq, Egypt, they can't go home because what will they go home to? Destroyed homes, no jobs, they won't go home. How are they going to live? How are they going to eat? And even worse, and I think this is maybe the most important point, we have done extensive opinion polling now in Arab countries. Why do young people join extremist groups like the Islamic State, like Al-Qaeda? Why do they do it? The answer is not because they hate Americans. The answer is they're pissed off because they have no jobs and they have no hope. I want to say that again. They're angry and they join extremist groups because they have no jobs and they have no hope. And we don't figure out how this is going to be rebuilt, it will be incubating extremists like the Islamic State and like Al-Qaeda for decades. It's already happening, frankly. And lastly, if you partition, watch what Hillary Clinton does. If you partition this, who's going to go fight these guys? Who's going to fight them? You think the Syrian government's going to fight them? The Syrian government hasn't been fighting them very much for the last 4 years. The opposition? No, the opposition's going to be fighting with the government. They're going to get a pass. The Americans are trying to raise an Arab army now to fight the Islamic State. That's what the fighting in Manbij last week, if any of you were following it, that's what this is about. The Americans have been largely unsuccessful because the Arabs want to fight Assad in Damascus. They don't want to fight the Islamic State. The Islamic State for them is a second priority. The Islamic State, by the way, the Syrian government has killed 7 times
more civilians, Syrian civilians, seven times more Syrian civilians in 2016 than the Islamic State did. So while the Islamic State's a priority for us, it's not a priority for a lot of the Syrian opposition. Assad is. So, in conclusion, where is this going? I think it's going to be a lot more fighting. I don't see any ceasefire. I don't think Kerry's going to get anywhere on Friday. I hope I'm wrong. Watch Aleppo, which is where the young boy in the hospital chair was injured. There'll be a lot more fighting around that. Aleppo has become a sort of Stalingrad for the Syrian uprising. Watch also, just today, if you were following the news, there was a Turkish incursion at Jarablus.
This is Jarablus right here. This is, if any of you, like if you were listening to NPR, you heard about the Turkish army coming in here, that's right here. And why are the Turks doing that? The Turks are doing that because the Syrian Kurds are moving this way, trying to take this space, and the Turks don't want them to have a continuous, independent Kurdish area here. So rather than let the Kurds take it from the Islamic State, the Turks decided to go in and do it themselves with Arab allies.
Those are the same Kurds that we were helping just a couple of weeks ago. As I said, I'm sure Joe Biden had an interesting day today in Ankara. Last thing, looking ahead, and then I'll shut up. In the weeks ahead, there's a lot of to-ing and fro-ing now. A lot of visits going on between Turkey, Russia, and Iran. A lot of visits. The Turkish president, Erdogan, after the coup, visited St. Petersburg. I cannot imagine they didn't discuss Syria. The Turkish president, Erdogan, is supposed to visit Iran sometime in the next week. Putin is supposed to go back to Turkey now at the end of August, so sometime next week. We all know they're talking about Syria. By the way, that has nothing to do with anything the Americans are doing. It has nothing to do with John Kerry. The Americans, as I said, are sort of irrelevant in this sideshow against the Islamic State. Turkey, Russia, Iran are clearly the key now to what's ever going to happen in Syria. So with that, thank you very much. I think I'm going to just ask Scott to come and talk. So let me introduce Scott. Scott studied at McGill in Montreal, and after spending some years as a musician, a performing musician, I'll let him talk about that, he also began volunteer work counseling victims of torture from civil wars, not in the Middle East, but in places such as West Africa. And from that volunteer work, Scott decided it would be good to get a law degree and to try to press legal processes against war criminals. He comes from a small organization called Committee for Justice and Accountability, CJA. Some of you may have heard that the CJA, Committee for Justice and Accountability, Scott and his colleagues, are working with the family of an American journalist who was killed in Homs in 2012. Homs is right here. And the government controls it now. The Syrian opposition did control it. And the government surrounded Homs in 2012. They besieged it, which means that they surrounded it. They allowed no medicine in. They shut off the electricity. They shut off the water. They would not allow medicine in. They would not allow food in. They would not allow anybody to leave. They wanted the people inside Homs to consume whatever sage supplies of medicine, food, water they had, and they just settled in a siege. And oh, they bombed it every day with artillery and later with aircraft. There was an amazingly brave American journalist, well known. Her name is Marie Colvin. Her name was Marie. Marie was known because she had an eye patch. If you Google her, you'll see the pictures with the eye patch. She lost an eye covering the war in Sri Lanka. She was killed by government artillery fire in Homs in February 2012. And Scott and his team are working with her family to pursue a legal case against the Syrian government for killing Marie. And not just Marie, of course, but they've killed, as I talked about, tens of thousands of other people. So I asked Scott if he would join me tonight to talk about what they're doing to bring justice to Syrians who have been the victims of the Assad government, and Scott was gracious enough to do that. This is his first trip to St. Johnsbury, by the way. So Scott, please.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here. Tough act to follow. I was kind of entranced with that presentation. I feel like I learned a lot, and I consider myself someone who's spent the last 4 years doing work in Syria. It's a lot to process. So I'm a human rights lawyer with the Center for Justice and Accountability. We are a nonprofit organization started in the late 90s, essentially to serve as a litigation arm of Amnesty International. At the time, Amnesty, of course, does a lot of fact-finding and reporting about human rights abuses. One of the things that they were finding in the 1990s were that there were a number of individuals who had participated, especially in Latin America, in the dirty wars, the 70s and 80s. And they were popping up here and there across the United States, fugitive war criminals, retired generals, former paramilitary leaders, living out a comfortable retirement in Southern California or Florida. And a number of victims, of survivors, very often living in the same town, the same community as these human rights violators, were coming forward to human rights groups and saying, well, there's a torturer living next door. What do we do? And this posed a key problem for them, because it's one thing to just write about a human rights violation, but it's another thing to actually be faced with the victim and the perpetrator living side by side in the United States, where we have a functioning justice system. You can't use the excuse that, well, our countries are devastated, we don't have functioning courts, we're just gonna let dogs lie. They said, no, these cases belong in a court of law. And so we were founded with the mission of tracking down fugitive human rights abusers on behalf of their victims, developing evidence against them, and trying to seek justice, which in a very classic American way might mean bringing a lawsuit against them. If it's all you can do is sue them, then sue them. And use that lawsuit, use the evidence that's flushed out to then try to build momentum, push the United States government to prosecute them. If we're not going to prosecute them here, send them back to their home country, and we, our NGO and others, will work with the home country to build their capacity to confront the abuses of the past and finally get justice. So that's sort of been our model, and it very much started out with looking at these fugitives, primarily from Latin America. I'll give you a couple classic illustrations of this for us. We found in the early 2000s that one of the former Salvadoran officials who had been involved in the killing of Archbishop Oscar Romero. Now, of course, Archbishop Romero was a Catholic archbishop in San Salvador. One of the leading figures of the liberation theology movement, which was trying to use Catholic teachings to address the situation of absolutely impoverished rural peoples, or the peasant society in El Salvador. He, of course, was famously assassinated while delivering a homily mass by a sniper, a gunman. Our investigation revealed that a Syrian former military officer, who in fact hired the driver and arranged for the getaway car that drove that sniper away from the killing of Archbishop Romero, was working as a used car salesman in Modesto, California. We brought a case against him on behalf of the family. He fled the country, he washed up in El Salvador. We're still working with the government there and bringing him to justice. But a federal judge entered a judgment against him created a long judgment, recording all of the evidence we had produced, which was the first ever judicial decision, recognizing that this was a planned, premeditated assassination. Another case that I had the privilege of working on came out of Florida, where there's a large Haitian-American community. Now, back in the 1990s, Haiti had its first ever, first democratic election. President Aristide was elected, and then, you know, within a year, overthrown in a military coup. A brutal military junta took power. It turns out that one of the leaders from this junta, after, you know, eventually the U.S. did have an intervention, the coup was removed from power. After this intervention, one of the military officers that was a leader of the junta washed up in Florida. How did we know he was in Florida? He won the Florida state lottery. And he actually had the gall, the brazen sense of impunity, to appear on television holding up one of those big, dumb novelty checks. And so members of the Haitian-American community in Miami said, what's this guy doing here? How can he be living here with total impunity? We were able to bring a lawsuit against him. We were able to win a judgment, a verdict, so a jury verdict. So a jury in Florida found that he was responsible for crimes against humanity, including assassination of labor union leaders and the systematic use of rape as a weapon of war. We were able to recover $500,000, what was left of his lottery winnings. And they were awarded to our clients who were survivors of the massacre. And they chose to divide up this money judgment in Haiti, back in their village, to all the family members of the survivors of this massacre. So that's sort of the model of how we've been working throughout most of the 2000s. Historic cases, looking at atrocities committed in the 1980s, maybe the early 90s, and the people that literally got away with murder because they were able to flee overseas. So this, our model sort of trying to get justice for these historic abuses was really challenged, I think, in a very fundamental way in 2011, when you had the outbreak of the Arab Spring revolutions that swept across the Middle East. And, you know, I followed this very, very closely. We had a sense that what we were looking at, in particular the government crackdowns on these social movements, was very, very similar to the type of brutality that you know, we saw in Chile from the Pinochet regime, or the type of brutality in Argentina or El Salvador or in Haiti. The difference was this was happening in real time. As we human rights investigators sitting here in the United States, we're sort of thinking, well, what do we do? How do we respond to this? And of course, you know, we're just trying to take in whatever information we can. In February 2012, as Robert mentioned, in the city of Homs in Syria, a turning point happened in the Syrian conflict. Now, for months, starting in March 2011, there had been massive, largely peaceful protests calling for an end to decades of dictatorial rule by the Assad family. The regime responded with a violent crackdown, so mass arrests, ramping up, eventually the arming of non-state paramilitary groups that went out and attacked demonstrations. And in the summer of 2011, you started seeing, for the first time, demonstrators, people in opposition-held neighborhoods, taking up arms to fight back. It started out as sort of defending demonstrations from government snipers, and eventually you saw the emergence of the first sort of organized rebel groups that started launching their own guerrilla-style military attacks against the regime's forces. So this was the situation in the summer of 2011. It escalated in the fall of 2011, and Homs, which is Syria's third largest city, became the focal point of all this. It was the city where the rebels, for the first time, were really able to take control of major urban areas and push the government forces out. and saying no more midnight raids, no more house-to-house searches, no more checkpoints set up in the middle of our neighborhoods. And so there was a bit of a standoff in a number of neighborhoods and homes where the regime started deploying heavier and heavier buildups of military forces and artillery. This was a bit unprecedented in Syria so far. In hindsight, we think of Syria as a raging civil war. But in those early months, we didn't know what direction it was going to go. But something was changing in Homs. And in the beginning of early 2012, it became very clear that the Syrian government had adopted a military solution to the crisis. And Homs was going to be the testing ground. Now, I learned about all of this sitting in Washington, D.C. at my desk, reading the news like anybody else. One of the most prominent reporters who was doing on-the-ground dispatches from inside the city of Homs was Marie Colvin, an American-born reporter for the British paper The Sunday Times. She was a veteran war correspondent. She had lost an eye through a grenade shot at her by a Sri Lankan government force. She saw something in Homs in January 2012, which in a sense was very prescient. I think of her sometimes as the canary in the coal mine. She saw the reports, the video footage being shot by just locals on their cell phones. She saw the systematic shelling of neighborhoods. And she said, this is like Sarajevo in Bosnia. She said, this is the new Sarajevo. And it has to be seen from the inside. There has to be someone telling the story. And so she smuggled herself in, entered inside the siege lines, and reported from within the besieged areas. And I know all this because I was reading her stories. And I'll never forget, on February 22nd, 2012, logged in, checking the news, and I saw that Marie Colvin had been killed. I saw that she and a French reporter, Remy Oschlick, died while they were reporting inside an apartment building that a bunch of local activists had set up with a satellite dish so that reporters could upload videos to the internet and get their stories out. And there was a concentrated artillery attack, multiple rounds directed against this one particular building, which killed Marie. And that affected me very personally, and I think it affected me in a way, this sort of goes back to the question that Robert opened with, why does Syria matter? Why should we care? Of course we can care because this is our fellow American citizen who was killed, doing incredibly important work. But there's something else about it that really struck me, which was that the only way that I know anything about Syria, the only way that any of us know what we know about Syria and conflicts around the world, is because some brave, possibly foolhardy soul took it upon themselves to enter into a blazing battlefield so that they could report it back to us. And it's only through that type of war reporting that we can make informed democratic decisions about how we should respond as an international community, and we can make informed decisions about the way of the world and our roles in it. And I think the Syrians knew that. I think they knew that it was by virtue of these foreign international war correspondents that were going in with the help of local activists and journalists, that they were the messenger, they were the bridge between the besieged populations and the rest of the world. And by killing the messenger, they tried to sever that link and tear down that bridge. And so for me, the attack that killed Marie Colvin was not just the killing of a US citizen, it was a deliberate attack against our conduit, our connection to the Syrian people. And I felt like that effort to isolate the Syrian people from the international community was one that really required a response. So I was retained by Marie Colvin's family to help them investigate this and undertook essentially a 4-year painstaking investigation of meeting with survivors of the attack, meeting with defectors, meeting with government sources to try to understand how did this happen. And what we've pieced together was that this was a deliberately planned targeted assassination, almost in the same way that Oscar Romero was deliberately assassinated through You know, his location was tracked down, he was followed, the whole thing was meticulously planned. And that's what we have found was behind the killing of Marie Colvin. But even more than that, I mean, just like the assassination of Archbishop Romero was not an isolated incident, it was part of a massive attack against civilians and activists and civil society members. The killing of Marie Colvin was just one of hundreds of incidents of media workers being targeted, arrested, tortured, forcibly disappeared, or targeted by military attacks. And so we and Marie's family see building a case based on her killing as a way to continue her work, as a way of continuing to tell the story of these ongoing attacks against the civilian population in Syria. So we took advantage of a law here in the United States that gives Americans, if an American has been killed overseas by a foreign government that's been designated as a state sponsor of terrorism, such as Syria, the law gives their family members the right to bring a case in court, which is a right that hundreds of thousands of Syrians who've been killed and their family members don't have. There is no court where they could bring a case. The International Criminal Court does not have jurisdiction over Syria. The Security Council twice has seen resolutions submitted for it, calling for them to refer the situation to the International Criminal Court. Those resolutions have been blocked by Russia and China. There is no court in the world that will hear the war crimes and crimes against humanity committed in Syria unless we can find through investigation some link, some connection that gives those courts of a foreign country jurisdiction. And so a lot of the work that we're doing is painstakingly trying to find either a victim, perhaps a foreign victim like Marie Colvin, perhaps a Syrian that has dual nationality, a dual American or dual British or dual French national, or increasingly, as there's been a massive flow of refugees out of Syria, there have been a number of former military and intelligence officials from the regime, also former rebel fighters and fighters from the Islamic State, that have slipped into neighboring countries, slipped into Europe. And so what we are going to see over the next decade, maybe even the next 20 years, is this process of tracking down those fugitives in the countries where they are and building cases against them. So I think with that, I might just, I'm not sure if we're taking any questions or,
So we have the case that Scott's Committee for Justice Accountability is bringing on Marie Colvin. There may be future cases, we'll see. So. Questions, comments? I'm retired, so I can speak frankly.
Bob, do you want to choose or
Richard? Okay, I'm just going to go from one side of the room to the other. So, Ms. Poole.
As you are advocating for legal action or potential legal intervention, I'm sure you must come up against people's fears. And in the case of the Middle East, I imagine you come up against people's prejudices at times. For example, people fear that Islam is a violent religion, or that Syrian refugees require extra screening, or that all Muslims should be banned from entering the United States. And I imagine it's hard to look at a 14-slide PowerPoint in these situations. What do you do? What do you say when you come up against misunderstanding? Or
here,
like that.
We haven't rehearsed. Just a couple of comments. I always just ask people to think about common humanity. I lived for 30 years in Muslim countries.
Would you use the mic, please?
Sure.
Thank you.
And repeat the question.
And repeat the question.
Thank you.
So, Miss, I'm going to try to summarize the question. When you're talking about a problem like Syria in the Middle East, you come up against a lot of prejudices and misconceptions among American, Europeans, people not from the Middle East. How do you deal with that? Would that be a fair
summer. So I would just say this. I talk to people about common humanity. I lived in Muslim countries for almost 30 years. My wife did as well. I think I can speak for Allison and say we were always treated, with the exception maybe of Syria, we were always treated with great respect. And I would even go so far as kindness. I'm going to tell a story about Syria. When I first went to Syria in 1983, I was a college student. I was studying Arabic in Cairo. I spoke Arabic reasonably well, but I was filthy. I had a mustache. I had hair. What a blessing. And it was long, and it came down to like here, and it was all curly. It was a mess. And I was a dirty backpacker. I mean, and I went to Syria in 1983. There were no guidebooks. And, you know, who went to Syria in 1983? And I went in August 1983. And for those of you who remember, Ronald Reagan had sent the U.S. Marines to Beirut. And the United States battleship New Jersey was shelling Syrian army positions just outside of Beirut. But me, being a blithering idiot 25-year-old, went into Syria as a tourist. And arrived very late at night, and I had the name of a hotel from an American who had been to Syria a year before, and that hotel was full when I got there at about maybe 11 at night. And he said, oh, well, there's another hotel down the street, try that hotel. Tried that hotel, full. He sent me to a third hotel, that hotel full. At the third hotel, by which time it was almost midnight, the desk clerk said, you will never find a room. Everything is booked. Why don't you come to my house tonight? You can crash there, you'd sleep there, and in the morning I'll bring you back down here, and people will be checking out, and you'll find a room. Now, I don't know about you, but being raised in upper middle class Denver, Colorado, my parents said, do not go home with strangers. And certainly, she never said it. She could have imagined I would get myself in such a mess in the first place. I'm sure she would have said, certainly don't go home with strangers in foreign countries that are state sponsors of terrorism like Syria. But it was either that or sleep on the street. So I went with this guy to his house. His sisters were still up watching TV. I feel kind of sorry for them because they got sent in the kitchen to make food. And I had dinner. I hadn't eaten because it was a long trip. And we stayed up talking until 4 in the morning. They were just delightful. They had never met an American. I never met a Syrian. Stayed up all night talking. And at 4 in the morning, Nazar, I still remember his name, said, I'm really sorry, you should get a little sleep because you really will have to leave tomorrow. If you don't leave, I'll have the secret police knocking on my door asking what you're doing here, and I don't want to deal with them. I'm like, secret police? Oh, I don't want to deal with secret police. I'll be out at 7 if you want. I don't know about you, but I actually don't know many people who would invite a complete stranger from a foreign country whose military was shelling my country's military and bring them into our home. Dinner and a place to sleep. That's Syria. That's why I love Syria. I hope Nazar is okay. I hope his sisters are okay. So I think you just have to bring the conversation. Don't get into Islamic ideology. Don't get into the whole, what is the Islamic State and what is it not? Just talk about people. That's what I do. I don't know, Scott.
I think that's absolutely right. I mean, common humanity is it's something that I have to confront because I interact with both survivors of horrific atrocities and also perpetrators. And sometimes I have witnesses who are former perpetrators. And they're human beings. They are monstrous in the sense that anybody put in the right context and under the right pressures could become a monster. But they remain human beings who have parents they love, siblings they care for, children they adore, favorite foods, favorite places to have a vacation. And I think it's always the key for me to try to understand and find some level in which you can relate to other people and understand their motivations. And that's sort of the first step to understanding the differences, understanding how it is that they might think or have a worldview that's so different from yours.
So another question. I'm going to go a little farther in the back. Sir with the mustache. Gray hair. Richard.
My question is about Assad. Mm-hmm. I remember back when he assumed power after his father, which was going to be this liberal and thing. You know, Syria was going to be much more freer and not suffer like Qatar did. Was that a myth, or was something triggered?
So, let me answer that. So, did to repeat the question, the gentleman asked when Bashar al-Assad, the son, the current president, took over from his father, who was quite brutal. The son had studied ophthalmology in Britain, had married a British Syrian banker. She used to work for Citibank. President Assad's wife is fluent in English, used to work for Citibank. I only had one conversation with me, and she told me, Mrs. Assad, she said, you know, I almost went to Harvard. I got a fellowship, and I was going to go to Harvard, and then Bashar asked me to marry him, and so I married him, and I thought at the time that was a mistake. But there was hope that this new young president and his, you know, wife, exposed to the West, lived in London, that they would be changed. They wouldn't be so brutal, you know. And the, you know, what happened? And I, two comments on that. Number one, I think there was a lot of hope and not a lot of analysis. The Assad family, with two other families that they're married into, basically runs the economy. They're very corrupt, they're very ruthless. When I was getting ready to go to Syria, I asked the assistant secretary of state, what should I read to get ready for Syria? Know any good books? And he said, oh, you don't need to read any books. Just watch a few episodes of The Sopranos. You'll understand right away how it works. And in fact, I think as Scott will tell you from the evidence that they're looking at with respect to Marie Colvin, that is how it works. It was never going to be what people hoped it was going to be, the hard analysis. Even now, that government, how can you like put in an independent, say, attorney general? How can you put in an independent police chief who would investigate all those dead bodies on the ground killed in the Damascus Military Intelligence Center, or the 17,700 killed in Syria? Once you start to peel that onion away, it's layers and layers of murder and corruption. And the regime really can't deal with that. And so they can't have any accountability. They can't have any transparency, therefore. And so you're stuck. I don't see how Bashar al-Assad now can reform. Do you want to add anything?
No, that says it all.
So I'm going to take another question from the left side of the room, and then I'll switch to the other side. So, sir, on the far end. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
And if you could raise your voice, just.
Yes, yeah. I will introduce myself, Alexander Strakanathan, Professor of History at Lyndon State College. And first comment, we were talking with Allison, and we still hope to see you at the premises of our college, which are
pleasure.
Now my question is, what do you think? I agree with many aspects that you covered in your presentation. Thank you. That was great. But I don't agree with some of them, too. In my opinion, what question that I would like to ask you, what our mistakes that contributed to this tragedy? Tragedy is unproportional, we agree. But should we learn lessons? And what are they? And do we have our responsibility, our foreign policy makers, for what is going on in the Middle East in general? Recalling the story of Iraq, Libya, and so on. Briefly, two other aspects. First is, I heard today that actually our Air Force covers Turkish incursion into Syria. If it is so, you can imagine the reaction of Kurds. So soon we will be between two hard places, Kurds and Turks. Kurds are our NATO allies, we cannot abandon them. Kurds are our, how far we can go in any direction.
Anti-Islamic state friends.
And the third question, do you really believe that Syrian opposition, such a nice guy? What about Jabhat al-Nusra? What about other Salafis that were supported by Salafis? What we will get if Assad is gone?
Fair question. So should I summarize quickly?
Yes.
So tell me if I'm doing this incorrectly or inaccurately. The gentleman asked, what mistakes did the Americans make and what can we learn from them? Second, are you so sure that the moderate opposition are really moderate, because there are extremists in their ranks? And number three, today's events, where Turkey and some of its Syrian Arab army groups that they've created have gone down in and fought the, gone over the border at Jarablus, as I pointed out on the map. Haven't we now placed ourselves in the middle because the American Air Force provided air cover? Haven't we placed ourselves in the middle of a fight between Turkey and Kurds? Would that be fair? Yeah. So on the first, what lessons can be learned? I think we'll be studying this for decades. The extent of the catastrophe is so big and American policy is so difficult to understand. I think there will be a great many PhD theses written about this. I've actually been contacted by a number of students around the world already. So this is what I take. This is what I take. Number one, President Obama should never have said Assad should step down unless he meant to make it happen. That was a bad mistake. And I'm partly responsible. They called me the night before he did it. I was on the telephone with them from Washington. I was in Damascus. And I didn't say don't do it. I said, it's not going to help us here, but if you have your domestic political reasons for doing it, I'm not going to object. That was a cop-out. My bad. I think the United States has lost enormous credibility saying that a foreign leader should step down and then not doing something to make it happen. That's the first. I think the second mistake we made was when the president said there's a red line against chemical weapons use, and he didn't defend it. He basically said we'll have a deal with on sarin gas, and now the Syrian government uses chlorine gas. I talked about that. So the Syrian government is still using chemical weapons. The United Nations is about to release a report that says that. American credibility, again, has sunk. I would much rather the Americans shut up than put lines in the sand and not defend them. Frankly, that's my opinion. Okay. Regime change, we never urged regime change. We urged negotiation. There's a big difference. The president said Assad should step down, and then he stood back. He said this is up to Syrians. This is our opinion, he should step down. I'd rather he'd not expressed an opinion. Diplomacy sometimes means, you know, shut up, don't say anything. Which leads then to the regime change, you know, would we get something even worse than Assad? So I'm going to put this to this group very bluntly. I heard last week one of Obama's former people speaking on British radio, and he said, well, if we got involved, it would get even worse than it is. I have to ask you, what really can get much worse in Syria right now? I mean, half the country is displaced. 500,000 are dead. Can it really get a lot worse, really? Seriously? I mean, this isn't 2011 anymore. Now it's 2016. That's a first. Second, I, for one, don't think extremists make up the large body, the majority of the Syrian opposition. They are important. They are growing, which is a problem. But they're not the majority. And if Assad went, frankly, I don't think the Islamic State would take over Syria. I don't even think Al-Qaeda would take over Syria. It'd be some wobbly coalition. Al-Qaeda might be a member in that coalition, not the Islamic State. Islamic State would never accept a coalition. They can't ideologically. But there might be some wobbly coalition of which Al-Qaeda might have a couple of ministers. Frankly, we're trying to get to that with the Taliban in Afghanistan. So is Syria so different? But it's not going to happen because Russia, Iran, and the Syrian government aren't going to accept it. So to me, the ideal is to get to a negotiation and let Syrians, not Americans, not Russians, not Iranians, Syrians, to negotiate it, including the different kinds of guarantees they want. How are we going to have a guarantee against the secret police knock on the door? Let Syrians negotiate it, not Russians, not Americans, not Turks, not Iranians. But we haven't been able to get to that negotiation. And I don't see any, I mean, I hope John is successful on Friday, but I'm not optimistic. So question now from the right side of the room. I'm going to go from the back and come front. So in the far back with the book in your right hand. Yeah. Oh, RB, how are you?
as the professor has observed, there really are no, with possible exception of the Kurds, there really are no good guys involved in the struggle in Syria. But is there a Syrian government in exile, or anything like it, which might help leverage the negotiations that you recommend?
To repeat the question,
yes.
The gentleman said there are no good guys, perfect guys, in the Syrian civil war. Is there a government in exile, or is there something that might help get us through to a transition period? Is that a fair summation, Harvey?
Okay.
So, first a comment. There are no angels in civil wars. There were no angels in our civil war. You know what? There were American soldiers in World War II who committed war crimes. I mean, let's be honest about it. And in the Syrian civil war, even the moderate opposition has committed war crimes. There was a horrible beheading committed by a group 2 weeks ago of a 19-year-old prisoner that they captured that had been fighting with the regime, and they videotaped it. It was disgusting. It was appalling. So there's no good guys, no perfect guys. I think, RB, there are some that are much worse than others. And so in this situation, I think you have to work with the ones that are less bad. As I once said to President Obama, in a civil war, there's black and white, and there are a lot of shades of gray in between. We need to get used to dealing in the gray zone. I think we'll have to. We're not going to get to a negotiation that means anything just waiting for guys with white hats, because they're not there, as you just said. So the real question is, can you figure out a way to construct a unity government so that there are some checks and balances with guarantees so that people feel safe and that can operate a government? One of the guarantees to me would be local villages, local neighborhoods provide their own security for a long time. So the local police come from the local community. Otherwise, people won't feel safe. You know, they're not going to bring in some people from the nasty town down the road to come and police us, because they'll go door to door. So it has to be local security. So, but I couldn't imagine you've got to have a whole structure of agreements like that. So another question from the right side of the room. Miss, yeah. Yeah.
Who were really both effective at combating the Islamic State and are also embarking on an incredible experiment with direct democracy and egalitarian forms of government. And they're desperately in need of humanitarian aid. I know that there's some American military aid going to them, but they need food, they need medicine, and there's a group that's trying to get at least to allow a humanitarian corridor to go through the Syrian Kurds territory. The Iraqi Kurds, sorry. It's very confusing.
Yeah.
I understand that. That's as much as I understand.
Yeah.
But so what can we do to help that situation?
Okay, yeah.
So if I can summarize the question briefly, the Syrian Kurdish area of Rojava has been an effective ally against the Islamic State and is trying some forms of democracy. Can't the Americans help them? They're giving them military aid, but they also need things like food and other supplies. Is that a fair summary? And you specifically asked about a humanitarian corridor. So now I'm going to take you in the belly of the beast again. I'm going to try to shout. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So the area that you're talking about is this area. This is Rojava. That's the Syrian Kurdish name for it. It's inside the boundaries of Syria. But it's called Rojava. That's the Kurdish name. These are the people who have fighters. They're called Peshmerga. They're local fighters, they're Kurdish, they speak Kurdish. As I said, they have their own culture. They are not Arabs. They're Muslims, they're Sunni Muslims, but they're not Arabs. And it's these people who started out with just this little space here to
few years ago at a place called Kobani and have been fighting the Islamic State, and the Americans, our Air Force has been bombing daily close combat air support for the last 2 years, and they have spread out like this and here. And in fact, they're moving to link up here so that this would all be yellow across there. So, can we help them? When I see in the New York Times that the Kurds in Syria have been our best allies against the Islamic State, it drives me crazy. Why? Nobody else in Syria has ever gotten close combat air support from the United States Air Force to fight the Islamic State. Do you think the close combat air support helps the Syrian Kurds? Yeah. Do you think if we gave it to some other opposition groups that are fighting the Islamic State, do you think it would help them? Yeah. So why are the Americans helping the Kurds and not helping anybody else? I have to tell you, I've asked that question for 3 years and I haven't gotten a clear answer, but I think it's this. I've asked people at the White House and State Department, why are you doing this? The answer seems to be this. These people are secular. They don't believe in mixing religion and government, and we're comfortable with that. We are less comfortable with people who want to like mix religion and politics, maybe create an Islamic State, not one like ISIS, but maybe one like, say, Qatar or Kuwait, or even maybe Saudi Arabia. We're not comfortable with that. We don't want to help those kind of people. And the second reason is these people here fight with an Al-Qaeda affiliate against Assad. And we're very uncomfortable giving any help to somebody who cooperates on the ground with Al-Qaeda, even if they're fighting against Bashar al-Assad, that President Obama himself said should step down. And so with the only people who've ever gotten post-combat air support, until today, when they went into Tripoli, have been the Syrian Kurds. So of course, they look like great allies. And in many ways, they are. You mentioned the democratic experiment. So what they're doing here in Rojava is they're holding elections. They're administered by Kurds. The elections are in Kurdish areas and in Arab towns. This area has a lot of Kurds, but it also has a lot of Arabs. It's not homogeneous, it's heterogeneous. They're administered by Kurds. They're setting up local councils. They're trying to create local administration. Remember what I said, they're not used to local administration in these places. Everything was run out of Damascus, state central government. So they're trying to set that up, and we'll see if it's a success or not. Maybe it will be, maybe it won't be. My experience in Iraq tells me if you've never done it before, it's gonna be bumpy. There are gonna be a lot of people with sticky fingers and that kind of thing. So we'll see. Any of you remember the bombing in Kobani when the Air Force was going in a year and a half ago, winter 2014, 2015? We were bombing every day just to rebuild Kobani, which is a town of roughly 15,000. They think it's going to take $6 billion. So, I mean, huge resources, huge. And, you know, there's not much money coming in. This area, I've been along the Turkish side of the border. I asked many times for permission from the Syrian government to visit this area, and the Syrian foreign minister always said, no, you can't go. But I've seen pictures of it. It's desert. At the book group, we had a number of people who had read a book called The Desert Queen about Gertrude Bell. Gertrude Bell frequently made this trip between Aleppo and into Iraq. So if you want to know what the terrain looks like, look at the Desert Queen and read about Gertrude Bell's visit. It's just flat, dry, looks kind of like New Mexico. If you've been to New Mexico just outside of Santa Fe, that's what it looks like. It's just kind of flat and dry. It's not sand dunes, it's not Lawrence of Arabia, it's just flat and dry. But it doesn't have a lot of resources. So where are they going to get $6 billion to rebuild? Well, and then get it from outside. So yeah, our foreign country is going to help, and I think so far nobody's put any money. With respect to food and food supplies, the Turks here close this border because they don't like these Syrian Kurds, because these Syrian Kurds are linked to terrorist Kurds in Turkey. So the food was coming in here from Iraq, and the Iraqi Kurds are very closely allied with the Turks, and so they've shut the border. And in fact, I was looking on Twitter today, there are a lot of complaints that the border is still closed. And so Rojava is in a world of hurt. And these are the people we're helping with our Air Force and our military aid. And I would presume this was all on the table today when Biden was in talking to the Turkish government, because the Turks have the ability to convince the Iraqi Kurds to open this border to food. One last thing I would say. The Syrian Kurds, the government there, is run by a party called the PYD. It's affiliated with the terrorist PKK. It's on our terrorism list. It's on Turkey's terrorism list. It's on the European Union's terrorism list. The PKK, which operates in Turkey.
So one last thing on Rojava, the yellow area. It's run by a political party called the PYD, Syrian Kurdish Political Party. That political party is closely affiliated with a group in Turkey, Turkish Kurds, called the PKK. The PKK is on the American terrorism list. The PKK is on the Turkish terrorism list. The PKK is on the European Union terrorism list. The PKK, just a couple of days ago, ambushed a patrol inside Turkey and killed two Turkish policemen and a child who was standing by the patrol when it got blown up. The Turks are furious that the Americans are helping on the Syrian side of the border a group affiliated with the PKK. And I know that was on Vice President Biden's agenda today. So the PKK, or sorry, the PYD in Syria, the PYD in Syria, last week began rounding up political opponents, and in a very Bashar al-Assad-like way. That's not good. So, I mean, I don't know how democratic they're going to be. My experience, frankly, from places like Iraq and Algeria, if you're not accustomed to dealing with freedom of speech, you just can't understand why somebody should have the right to criticize you publicly. And I think the PYD is having a hard time with public criticism, and so they're arresting opponents. Even Erdogan in Turkey is having a hard time with freedom of speech these days. So it's not limited to the Syrian. To the Syrian Kurds. I myself, after 30 years working in this part of the world, I have no hope that there can be democracy anytime soon. I would just like them to begin to respect basic human rights like freedom of speech and accountability and some transparency. Elections, to me, push them way back. Push them way back. They have to learn the building blocks before they can become full democracies. So, another question. Yes, sir. You've been very patient.
Can you put the map of the Middle East
down? Sure.
It's more of a comment than a question, but I think this is, when you look at the Middle East, it's a classic case of history coming home to roost. You talk about Kurt Cugel, I read that book.
Yeah.
And how, talk about lines in the sand, these countries were created artificially by placing lines in the sand. They don't bear any relationship to the ethnic or nationalistic impulses of the population. So we had the same discussion in Iraq that we should partition it into three areas. So I guess, you know, I guess what is the hope, given that these are artificially created nations, they're not really nation states?
So two comments on it. Number one, the borders were, in many cases, drawn by European countries. That's absolutely true for World War I. They were drawn out mostly in the early 1920s. They are sort of the minimum that people have agreed on. Like, they can live with that. They may not like it, but they can live with it. So changing the borders involves a whole set of complicated negotiations, and when the negotiations don't go well, it's my town. No, it's my town. Or, just as often, it's my water resource. No, it's my water resource. Remember, this is a very arid desert area, the whole area. When they argue like that, frequently then you get into armed conflict. So changing the borders is not easy. I mean, it's going to be very difficult. We found in Iraq, when we were there, the American administration of Iraq, before the Iraqi government stood up, right after Saddam fell, and the Americans were trying to figure out, should we rejiggle some of the electoral districts to make them a little more sane? It was immediately clear that it was going to be exceptionally complicated, and it was much better for the Americans not to touch it. There were lots of sensitivities that we didn't begin to understand, which then is my second point, which is, if there are going to be any negotiations there, Scott, please don't take offense, but nobody in Washington should be involved. Nobody in London, nobody in Paris, nobody in Moscow, nobody in Ankara, nobody in Tehran. If you're going to redraw the border between Iraq and Syria, Iraqis and Syrians and nobody else. If you're going to redraw the border between Syria and Turkey, Syrian and Turks, nobody else. Getting a lot of foreigners into it will almost certainly screw it up. And so one of the things that makes me very uncomfortable with this whole partition of Syria idea is we've got people in Washington drawing out lines of, you know, where one state should end and the other begin, and new there are literally people in Washington writing new constitutions for Syria someday. Like, please. So, you know, Syrians have to do that. Syrians have to buy into it. Otherwise, it's not going to be respected. So, that's my point. Shall we keep going?
You have a lot of stamina, and
people
here
are melting in the heat. Yeah.
More questions? There are. I will leave it to you to bring this evening to a close.
Okay. Let's just take two more. Yeah, let's just take two more, and then I'm going to release you from purgatory here. So in the front, yes, ma'am.
Do you anticipate the refugees will ever come back?
Go back to Syria?
And if so, where do they go to come back to?
I don't think they're going to go back anytime soon because they have nothing to go back to in most cases. Their homes have either been destroyed or they've been taken by other people from an opposing side. So they wouldn't have any place to live. They won't have jobs to go back to in many cases. And until the economy gets an injection of investment and an injection of resources to rebuild destroyed roads, to rebuild destroyed water, to rebuild destroyed power plants, to rebuild destroyed schools, hospitals, there will be no services, and you got to have money to do that, and Syria has no money. So I don't think the refugees are going to go home. I think for the people in Rutland who are looking at bringing 100 Syrian refugees, they need to understand they're probably going to be there a long time. Maybe someday this will be put back in a way that, you know, maybe the parents will want to go home. I don't know if a 2 or 3 year old child who comes over here at such a young age would ever want to go home. I don't know. I can't answer that question. So we're going to have the artist who did this artwork here. He's going to come in a couple of weeks, and he's Syrian. He has a green card. And I'd ask him that question, are people going to go home? So he's dealing with Syrian refugees down in Connecticut. So, but I think just looking at it in a cold, hard, analytical way, they won't have much to go home to, so I don't think they're going to go home anytime soon.
What are they going to do?
They come to the United States. They get an apartment, often in a bad part of town, because they have no money. They get some English language training, and then they're told to go out and find a job. And the kids go into school, and I think the schools have to arrange special English classes for them because they don't speak English. Very few of them speak English. So it's a hard life here. And again, I would urge you, people who are interested in the situation of Syrian refugees and the prospects for Syrian refugees here in Vermont, come to the Mohammed Hafez discussion. Mohammed and his wife, Danya, I met him at Yale, but Mohammed and his wife are doing a lot of volunteer work with the large Syrian refugee community that has settled in New Haven, Connecticut. They have, I think, 40 families. Is it, Allison, you know how many? It's about 40. And Mohammed is very sober about the challenges. You know, there are good days and there are bad days. So,
So I just want to add one other thought to the question of, could the refugees go back? For many, I mean, if, you know, there are refugees with different motivations for why they left. But many, many thousands of the refugees leave because they fear the regime. And they absolutely fear that having left the country, they would be viewed by with suspicion if they ever were to return. And there's a lot of basis for that. There are reports of Syrian government documents that have been leaked, whistleblowers have brought out. Some of them I haven't independently verified, so I can't necessarily vouch for their authenticity. But there are reports of at least 1.6 million arrest warrants issued by the secret police in Syria for Syrian citizens, for foreign nationals. Many, many refugees, if they try to return and the regime is still in power, that's what they're facing, is very likely being wanted by the regime if they're perceived to be pro-opposition, wanted by former rebels if they were perceived as being pro-regime, wanted by ISIS if they ever spoke out against ISIS. So even if there were some kind of lasting ceasefire, cessation of hostilities, it's hard to even imagine how it would be conceivably safe to go back with your family and think that you could rebuild a life there. And that's why you have people choosing to take a raft, an inflatable raft, across the Mediterranean rather than face that reality.
I had not heard about the 1.6 million arrest warrants, but I wouldn't put it past the Syrian government. Last question, and I'll come back to the left side of the room. Yes, Miss.
You mentioned vaguely the resources. I'm wondering about the proposed pipeline through Syria. Where is it supposed to go?
Yeah.
And what does that have to do with the interest of the United States
yeah.
and other...
Yeah. Who is it, I think, so let me repeat the question, and I'll summarize, you correct me if I'm wrong. Isn't there a pipeline, oil pipeline project across Syria, and does that figure in any of these geopolitical swirlings around Syria with all these countries? Is that a fair summation? So I think I read an article by the son of Bobby Kennedy, which had this in it. And I have to say, it was one of the dumbest things I've ever read. And they were very nice to me at the Kennedy Library a few years ago, but I don't know, I didn't meet the son, I met Bobby Kennedy. And there is an oil pipeline project. It's actually not a standing project. It's an old oil pipeline.
The old oil pipeline goes from up here in Iraq, across Syria, and out to the Mediterranean, so that tankers could load up on the Mediterranean and take the oil from Iraq to Europe. That project predates supertankers. Now you have these gigantic ships that take much larger volumes of oil. I'm not even sure the ports in Syria today could handle a supertanker. I'm pretty sure they could not.
So I think that pipeline does not figure high in Russian calculations. I know it doesn't figure high in American calculations. I don't think it figures at all in Turkish calculations.
So you don't think that oil is...
No. Syria doesn't have a lot of oil. It has a little, and it's very high sulfur content. It's very, what we call, thick, heavy oil. It takes a lot of money to refine it into something like heating oil or gasoline. It's not like the nice, sweet, low sulfur crude that they pump out of Saudi Arabia, or they pump out of Kuwait, or they pump out of Abu Dhabi. It's low grade oil. In fact, most of the Syrian oil before the revolution went to China. The Chinese could use it. So I don't think oil is not really an issue in Syria. Oil might be an issue at times in Iraq, but not so much in Syria. I think people are suffering with the heat.
I just want to say a big thank you. To all of you for coming, and please continue to follow what we're doing here. We'll continue to provide some resources for you.